Hi everyone, today we're going to be looking at the BRX BRX Do-More PLC HTTP web server. Now, detailed information contained in the video can be found at accautomation.ca. A link has been put in the description below. If you have not watched the other videos yet, there'll be links in the description below that will start you at video 1. There'll be links to the rest of the videos in the series as well. So, the first thing we do is take a look at the latest software version, which is 2.8, and what we need is that version or higher in order to enable our HTTP web server. So if we go over to the website, the download softwares from the Automation Direct website, you'll see right here, and the latest version is 2.8, and you can just download that here. Now this link will be provided in the description below. So once we have that downloaded, we can then call up our software, and under our firmware, we have to make sure that our actual hardware itself has the same firmware on it. So we'll go PLC, update firmware, and you can see here that I have 2.81 for our operating system. And then our booter, we have 1.08. So these are the latest ones. We can just check if we want to, and there's no new files. We'll say okay, and we'll close that down. Next, what we'll do is we'll actually enable our HTTP web server. So if we go PLC, and then we can go system configuration, or we can go over to under tools, under system configuration, that'll get us to the same location. We click it, and what we'll do is go down to our web server, HTTP, and then we ensure that that's enabled, and then we'll click on HTTP settings, and we'll see that we have the maximum concurrent sessions is 4. What that means is that we can have 4 web browsers pointing to our location. Then we have our TCP port number. The default is 80, which is what we have. Then we have our enabled features that we have. So we have our REST API, our info pages, static pages, etc. And we'll go through that once we call up our web browser. We'll hit OK. Then we have something called the whitelist, and we will enable our server whitelist. Now what this will do is it will put us some security on the network, so only specific IP addresses will be able to communicate to our server and different services on our CPU, which is either going to be the Do-More designer software simulator, or it's going to be an actual BRX BRX series CPU. So in our case here, we have each service highlighted, and then we specified a range of addresses, so anywhere from 1.2 to 1.200 in our network. So basically all the computers that we have in our network will be able to communicate to this BRX. So it's a good way of limiting who can actually communicate, or who can, in this case here, program or do the Modbus TCP or Ethernet IP or the HTTP and REST API. So we'll just hit cancel out of that. So once you've got that added, then what we can do is we will look at our local IO. So what we're going to do is actually going to connect a analog input to our analog input on our BRX controller, and we're going to connect a digital input, which is going to be a capacitive proximity sensor. So looking back at our system configuration, we'll go to the BRX local IO. We'll look at we can either look at here, the IO, and go to configure analog IO, or we can go to analog right here, and then there's our inputs and outputs. In our case here, we're going to use our voltage input tester that we made from a battery, 9-volt battery, and a potentiometer. And we're going to feed that into our input signal here, which is 0 to 10 volt DC. We're going to enable the scaling, so WX0 to RX0, so the real value. So we're going to go from 0 to 32,767 to 0 to 1,000, representing like a percentage. or a voltage. Right, so that's how we set our analog in. So cancel there, cancel there. And in order to set those or to develop that, if we go back, you can see that we've actually created a website or a web thread that tells you actually how to create this analog input signal. It's located right here. So just a simple 9-volt battery and then a potentiometer. And that'll feed in 0 to 9 volts, so which is good for testing out this type of thing. Also, we're going to be wiring in our capacitive type proximity sensor, and we're going to wire it in NPN. And that's going to just trigger the first input to the PLC. So looking back at the PLC program, you'll see here that we're taking our first input, which is the proximity sensor, and turning on the first output. So that is our simple program that we have. So we download this to the, or transfer it to the PLC. So now let's take a look at the hardware that we have. And we'll just call that up. There we go. So on our hardware, you'll see here's my BRX controller. It's the BX-DM1E-18ED13. And we are communicating through our Ethernet port located right here. You can see that we have our analog input, which is my potentiometer. It's going into that first analog input right here. And then we have our capacitive prox, and you can see here, this is a signal. It's indicating that it is on. You can see our input is on and our output's on. So our program is functioning. If I hold up that proximity sensor, you can see it turns off and the output turns off. On, off. So let's leave it on for now. And then next on our testing, what we have to do is call up our website. So we go to our website here, and what we have to show you first though is through the system configuration, our IP server right here, and the IP server of this BRX unit or BRX Do-More PLC is 192.168.1.11. We can configure this, and when we configure it, we have to make sure that we actually use a static IP address. This ensures that we know exactly what the value is to put on the IP address in order to reach that website. So I said okay. Okay, so we have that all set. Now let's go back to our web browser. We'll put in our static IP, 192.168.11. And when we do, what you'll see is that because we are on the white list, we've listed this controller, you can now see our information. And here's our type again with our description. You'll see a serial number, you'll see the IP address, which is the one we typed up here. You'll see the mode, the key switch is in terminal mode, and we're actually running our program. You can see our scan times, the min, the average, and the max. And then you can see the memory used. So we haven't used much memory since we only have one line of logic in our controller. Then you'll see our version number, and you'll see our system time clock. So our next would be our status. And here's our status for latest errors and warnings. Then we go into I/O page. In the I/O page, you can see here that we have our analog input and we have our digital input and digital output. So first of all, let's lift that capacitive proxy and turn it off. When we turn it off, you'll see that they turn off. Turn it back on, they turn back on. So the website's actually quite responsive. And now let's take a look at our analog signal. And what we'll do is just turn that up. And you can see that how our analog is reading. So we'll turn that right up. That's about right. Okay. So that seems to be working functioning as well. Next, we'll have our data view. And our data view, it actually shows similar to what our data view is on our Do-More designer software. And you can see here that we've looked at X1 and we've looked at 128 of them. So again, we're looking at our first input here and the first output right here. Again, let's try that out. We'll lift up our capacitive proximity sensor and you'll see that they go off and then back on again. Now, if we want, we can add two more elements. So let's put in our WX0, which is going to be our analog input. And we'll just put 1 for our count, update that. And then you can see here that we have WX0 with our value right here. And you can see as I turn it, it's responding again to the signal. If I add our scaling feature that we did, so that was our X0. And again, we'll put a count of 1, hit update. And now we have our X0, and well, we have the scaled value here. So we're at about 3.2 volts right now coming in to our unit. So next on our website and our web pages here, we'll look at our system log. Our system log here just tells me when things change or what things happen. So here's my system log right now, and I can go right through all the different values and terminology here, and you see when it was turned on and off, etc. Then we have our user log, and a user log can be used to create your own messages that you want to display. So again, this is very good for troubleshooting. So you can see your physical I/O. You can actually look and program in some memory when you know certain conditions are going to happen in the PLC. Then finally, we have our user pages. And this is what we'll do next time. We'll take a look at some user pages and where we can put in some websites of our own or web pages of our own to display the information. So that is our web server, HTTP, on our BRX Do-More PLC. Now, if you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button below. If you have any questions about the video, please leave a comment below and I'll do my best to answer it. If you want more information about us or you want our free ebooks on numbering systems or robust data logging, please click on the link in the description below to get it. A new video is put out every Monday, so make sure you hit the subscribe button so you get more videos like this in the future. Remember to click that bell beside your subscription to actually receive those notifications. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you next time. Stay safe.